I, Dr. Sayyed Afroz Ashrafi, on behalf of Literary Responses, welcome you all to yet another edition of the talk which is going to be on Dalit literature today. And I will be in conversation with Dr. Anil K. Prashad, once again a very important personality and as important as he has been in all deliberations of this kind. And it's my privilege to introduce my guest speaker and my subject expert, who is Dr. Anil K. Prashad. Anil K. Prashad has been a very accomplished academician. He has been an intellectual par excellence, has taught at different international universities, has a wealth of experience, both academic and intellectual. So I chose him because I couldn't find anybody other than him or better than him who could have spoken on these issues. So Dr. Anil K. Prashad, please, I welcome you on behalf of the Literary Responses. Dr. Madhavi and Dr. Jyotsna Prashad, welcome you all to this show. And this evening, as I said, I will be talking on Dalit literature. And the topic is Dalit literature today, which means that we are going to be very contemporary and we are going to be very updated on whatever is happening to Dalit literature or discourse as it goes. Dr. Anil, my first question to you is, do you think Dalit literature is conceived in ire and delivered in fire, and it moved from fantasy to ecstasy and from ecstasy to reality? This is the question, sir.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to thank Literary Responses for inviting me this conversation with Dr. Afroz Ashrafi. And thank you very much for your generous introduction. The question is that how Dalit literature was conceived. Yeah. One of the most important movements that emerged in post-independence India, Dalit literature, was conceived in pain, poverty, sorrow, helplessness, hunger and humiliation. The highest purpose of Dalit literature was to reclaim dignity and justice, self-respect and equality. I would like to answer your question of ire, because it originated from the space of anger, and anger in Dalit literature became a very stereotypical, a common stereotypical space. But let us see and let us examine one poet who is very modern. Her name is Sukirtha Rani. She is from Tamil Nadu. And she says, she's a modern poet, she's a teacher. She says that the moment you come out of your house, caste chases you like a dog. She talks about her segregation at school. It is not only Sukirtha Rani who talks about this. Om Prakash Balmiki talks about it. Dr. Tulsi Ram talks about it. And almost all people, mostly in their autobiographical novels and poems, they talk about it. And outside, shopkeepers, they try to do something when they exchange money, make them feel that they are different. So when they look at it and look back at the past, and when they recount and retell them either as a poem or as a novel, they look back in anger. Okay. And they try to identify this anger, this kind of suppression, humiliation, segregation. And there's a poem by her in which she says that the Dalit woman can also kill. And her very famous poem is a poem named Flag of Freedom, in which it talks about the parts of human body. And she said that it is like a flag, and the color of the flag is the color of blood. So this explains how ire is strong in Dalit literature. So as I said, Dalit literature is about human rights, it is about human dignity, it is about individual and communal identity, and seeks to redress for historically persistent oppression and social justice in the present. And there is a silence of generations that has been broken by certain writers. And there are three important writers, very important, of Marathi literature, that they broke the silence, the historical silence. Baburao Bagul, Sharad Patil, and Sharan Kumar Limble. What did they do? They provided the theoretical framework through which Dalit literature is viewed in India. The major works that argue for a theory of Dalit literature came from them, namely, first, Bagul's Dalit Sahitya, Today's Science of Revolution, published in 1981, and Patil's 1988 work, Aesthetics of Non-Brahminical Literature. And the third one is Limble's 2004 book, Towards an Aesthetics of Dalit Literature. Among these three, Patil is an erudite scholar of history and art and aesthetics and politics. Referring to your question of ire and fire, that is in the Dalit literature everywhere, most of the works of Dalit literature, the novels, they are autobiographical, and in their autobiographical work, experience is a part of Dalit literature. It is about human condition. It is created by those who have been rejected as human beings in the caste-based society. And it is an attempt to regain their humanity. The purpose of Dalit literature is not to create art, but to bring mental liberation through art for creation of enlightened India, to quote, unquote, B.R. Ambedkar, what he calls Prabuddha Bharat. Limble's autobiography, Akkar Mashi, published in 1984, it has been translated as The Outcast, but the correct translation would be Half Caste. When you talk about fantasy, it is not really a fantasy, but it is a kind of desire to imagine. But it is not only a desire to imagine, but a need to imagine a casteless life that derives from understanding of man and nature, man and man, and the upper caste and the lower caste, the people who are on the margin, the people who are at the center. Bagul, Patil, and Limble, they have common grounds. And these common grounds are emergence of personal experience, because personal experience is very important in Dalit literature. What they call anubhuti and sahanubhuti sympathy and compassion, but there is another element that is called empathy, wrongly translated as sahanubhuti. Empathy is translated as samanubhuti. When you have the similar kind of experience, we call it empathy. So here, emergence of personal experience, because that is the raw material that we find in Jutan, that we find in Akkarmashi, that we find in Dr. Tulsiram's Murdahiya. This is also not much talked about, but it is, from my point of view, it is one of the important books of Dalit literature. Murdahiya, and the second part is Manikarnika. So emergence of personal experience, revival of Buddhism. And the third one is rejection of Brahminical aesthetics. I will come to Brahminical aesthetics later on. But if you allow me to read out some parts of Akkarmashi, that would be very revealing and very important to understand what is fantasy, what is ire, what is social realism. I have in my mobile phone. Yes. So Akkarmashi is half caste. So why this name is half? Why is this name half caste? The reason is here that my mother is an untouchable. My mother is an untouchable, while my father is a high caste from one of the privileged classes of India. Mother lives in a hut. Father lives in a mansion. Father is a landlord. Mother landless. I am Akkarmashi, half caste. I am condemned, branded, illegitimate. I regarded the immorality of my father and mother as a metaphor of rape. My father had privileges by virtue of his birth, granted to him by the caste system. His relationship with my mother was respected by society, whereas my mother is untouchable and poor. Had she been born into the high caste, or were she rich, would she have submitted to his appropriation of her? It is through the Dalit movement and Dalit literature that I understood that my mother was not an adulteress, but a victim of social system. I grow restless whenever I read about a rape in the newspaper, a violation anywhere in the country I feel is a violation of my mother. I have put in words the life I have lived as an untouchable, as a half-caste, as an impoverished man. There is a Patil in every village who is also a landowner. He invariably has a whore. I have written this so that readers will learn the ooze of the son of a whore. High caste people look upon my community as untouchable, while my own community humiliates me, calling me Akkarmashi. This humiliation was like being stabbed over and over again, unquote. So this is what is social reality, comes out of experience. Now, the experience that is there, put forward as arguments, they are shaped by the influence of these three thinkers in Dalit literature. That is Karl Marx, Mahatma Jyotirao Phule, and B.R. Ambedkar. Now, Limbley, in one of the poems, talks about the Brahminical treatment of the people. Quote, the church bell rang, everyone entered, the ajan heard from mosque, everyone entered in, the bell of temple rang, some entered in and some stood up. So the segregation is there. The fire you talked about, the ire and fire you talked about, it is beautifully expressed in one of the poems of Odia poet, named Mukti. The name of the poet is Bichitrananda Nayak. Quote, "They are raised now. They are awakened. Awakened from this mass slumber. They will burn down the establishment for their bread and butter. They have already given a call and are ready to shed their blood with red tears." So this is the end of the first question. Next question, please.
Thank you very much, sir, for a very comprehensive response to a very ordinary question like whether this literature was literature of fire and fire, and whether it started all as a fantasy and finally culminated into a kind of a very serious reality of sorts, to which you have already responded to the best of everybody's satisfaction, and that was a very convincing kind of a response. Thank you very much, sir, for that. Moving on to the next question, because the next question almost a rehash of whatever I have already asked, and the next question relates to: do you think, sir, that this Dalit literature is a literature of insurrection and political empowerment while seeking human dignity? So the two important aspects of this question are: one is the whether it was a literature of insurrection, and the second one, whether you find that this literature was seeking some kind of a political empowerment and with focus on human dignity. Sir, your response, please.
As I said, that Dalit literature is literature of anger and helplessness, violence, fortitude, pain, sorrow, despair, hope. It is not a celebration. And it is a cry for dignity and self-respect. It is a quest for identity and equality. It is a genre of humanism and sometimes violence. Now, we have already Akkarmashi, the outcast. We have got the autobiographies of Baby Kamble. It's a very famous autobiography that talks about insurrection and political empowerment of Dalit people. It has been translated into English as "The Prisons We Broke, Jinnah Amucha." The Prisons We Broke. And then we have Banna Faustina Susiraj, whose novel is Karukku in Tamil. And then we have Om Prakash Balmiki Jutan. So all these are talking about the insurrection and political empowerment of the people with their mediated experience and their artless outpouring and repetitive stereotypical experience of their pain, their childhood, their growth, and their neglect, living in a filthy surrounding, and humiliated at schools and all ghettos, yes. But they are realistic, they are authentic, they are experienced best. And what is important, that they threaten the hegemony of upper class in society. Now, Baburao Bagul, who is the pioneer of Dalit literature and whose short story published in 1963, "When I Had Concealed My Caste," became very important. And all these talked about what you said, the ire and fire and the political empowerment and their place, their identity in the society, their proper place in the mainstream social harmonious structure of the society. So that is my answer. And the next question, please.
Okay, so thank you very much once again for going into the details of the question and deconstructing the question with the best possible response. So, moving on to the next question, which says that while breaking the silence of the silence of the Dalit literature, while breaking the silence of the silence, Dalit literature sought to create a resistance emerging from the shadows of ghettos to challenge the Brahminical hegemony. That is to say that this, the very emergence of Dalit literature was to challenge the hegemonic structure of this Brahminical control. So they were trying to come up with a parallel kind of a response for not being acknowledged or recognized by what you call the upper crest of the society. So how do you react to this question that they broke the silence of the silenced?
That is a very important question. But one thing we have to remember, that Dalit movement is against Brahminism, not against Brahman.
Okay. That's the final point to be noted. Yes, sir.
Dr. Jaya Prasad has a question. I will come to it and I will answer towards the end.
We will respond to that towards the end, yes.
So, Dalit movement is against Brahminism, but not against Brahmins. Brahminism can be found even in the Shudras, because it is a mental state, and this mental state forces them to dominate. So, Brahminism is about a common condition of exploitation and oppression by the upper caste of the Indian society. So what happened, this Brahminic domination of the Dalit exploitation? Number one, from the ancient times, they deprived Dalits from knowledge and education because they wanted to maintain a status quo that they will not claim the right to education, and Vedas not allowed even to hear. Dalit women were forced to work, making them silent. They are the people of lower caste, untouchables. They were denied of higher training of mind and socioeconomic status, and that's why they had inhuman condition. So this is what I understand by your question, that is Brahminical against the
hegemony.
Yes, Brahminical hegemony. So that is my answer to your question. Okay. So next question, please.
Thank you, sir. Very much. Once again, you have answered the question very much on the lines I would have expected from you or of you, and that's a very intelligent response from you. There's no question about that. On to the next question, sir, because this question particularly for me is an important one. I don't know how will you react to this question of mine. Because since we are talking about Dalit literature, and talking of Dalit literature without any reference to Ambedkar directly will possibly be not very, will be very cynical if we put that way. Yes, my next question is, do you think Dalit scholars reread Ambedkar after 1990 and proposed an alternative anti-caste intellectual tradition in Indian history? Do you think they read Ambedkar, thereby the Dalit writers reread Ambedkar in 1990s, and from there you find that they were trying to propose an alternative anti-caste intellectual tradition in Indian history? Yes, sir, please go ahead with this one.
So far as I understand, Dr. Ambedkar is the sole inspiration, he is the ultimate inspiration, he is the doyen of Dalit literature. Even he influenced Dalit Panthers, and today, most of the Dalit writers, they are inspired by his speeches and writings. And they made a new critical idiom of the post-colonial period. The writings of Dr. Ambedkar, like Mook Nayak, Bahiskrit Bharat, Janta Samta, and his organization of Bahiskrit Hitakarini Sabha, they are very important. Dr. Ambedkar is remembered for his political gain today. This is very unfortunate that he is remembered for his political gain, and we remember him for our political gains, but we ignore his writing.
Yes, we do.
Dr. Ambedkar said, quote, he once said, quote, "It is utterly disgraceful to sell your human rights for a few crumbs of bread. We will attain self-education only if we learn self-help, regain our self-respect, and gain self-knowledge." Regarding the presence of Dr. Ambedkar, you'll be surprised to know that he is sometimes character in the novels written by the Dalit writers. For example, Narendra Jadhav, in his novel Outcast, he has made Dr. Ambedkar a character. Dr. Ambedkar said, quote, "Education is the weapon with which you change the world." There is another writer whose name is Anna Bahu Sathe. She is a Marathi writer. She has a poem, "Take a Hammer to Change the World." Here, hammer is symbol of Dr. Ambedkar. Allow me to read the poem so that things will be clear.
Please go ahead.
"Take a hammer to change the world. So saying went Bhim Rao. Why the elephant is stuck sitting in the mud of slavery? Shake your body out. Come out. Take a leap to the forefront. The rich have exploited us without end. The priests have tortured us as if eaten jewels, and thieves have become great. Sitting on the chariot of unity, let us go forward to break the chains of class and caste. Hold to the name of Bhim." So this amply shows that Dr. Ambedkar is very much influential. He is the soul and ultimate inspiration for the Dalit literature. Now there is a modern writer, Daya Pawar, in his novel, Baluta. It is a semi-autobiographical novel dealing with forced labor. He is influenced by Dr. Ambedkar. Dangu, the protagonist, is influenced by Dr. Ambedkar. And Gujarati novel, Diwali, by Dalpat Chauhan, in which there is a marriage by a lower caste boy who has fallen in love with the upper caste girl, and that is not possible. And the same kind of pattern we have in Jutan, the same kind of incident we have in Jutan, and also in Tulsi Ram's Mardahiya, when his father is trying to help children to cross the river to go to school, he one day helped a upper caste girl to cross the river, and it was seen by some upper caste boys, and the next month she got married, and she was crying when she was to depart, that my study was disrupted, I could not continue my study like this. So all these things, they were influenced by Dr. Ambedkar. And this is very, very important that Om Prakash Balmiki is heavily influenced by Dr. Ambedkar. And he accepts and he acknowledges that his life of longest struggle had shaken me up, quote, my stone-like silence had suddenly begun to melt. While talking about the influence of Dr. Ambedkar, he writes, Om Prakash Balmiki, that his stone-like silence had suddenly begun to melt. In the similar way, Bama, another writer, talks about Ambedkar's influence and his call for both men and women to have education for freedom. Education is as necessary for females as it is for males, Dr. Ambedkar said. And this is also in Baby Campbell's novel, Prisons We Broke, mentioned. And I measure the progress of community by the degree of progress which women have achieved, Ambedkar said. At this point, I would like to quote the great personality Kamala Bhasin, who passed away recently, what she talks about the education of girls in her poem. Allow me to read it, because here it is very important that how she was also an activist for the downtrodden. So the title of her poem is, Because I am a Girl, I Must Study. Look at the variations and referent of this poem, how powerfully she expresses the feelings. For my dream to take flight, I must study. Knowledge brings new light, so I must study. For the battles I must fight, I must study. To avoid destitution, I must study. To win independence, I must study. To fight frustration, I must study. To fight inspiration, to find inspiration, I must study. Because I am a girl, I must study. To end my silence, I must study. To challenge patriarchy, I must study. Because I am a girl, I must study. To mold a faith I can trust, I must study. To sweep centuries of dust, I must study. Unquote. So this is the end of my answer, but would like to add a very short thing that Dr. Ambedkar urged people, his people, educate, agitate, organize.
Organize, right.
Educate, agitate, organize. Next question, please.
Okay, sir. So thank you very much for once again a very compendious kind of a response on a question which was on the importance of Ambedkar. And one thing which is important here to highlight is that Dr. Ambedkar is central to Dalit imagination. So most of the literature, right from Bahiskrit Bharat, which he wrote in 1936, and the Annihilation of Caste, the text of the undelivered speech by him, because he wasn't allowed to deliver that speech, again under the durst of the same caste structure, which almost ostracized him. So that kind of a response which you gave, which again highlights the predicament of the Dalit writers, and Ambedkar being integral to their imagination, that they cannot exist in isolation from whatever Dr. Ambedkar entailed in terms of the emancipation of the subaltern segments of the society, and more directly the Dalit empowerment through literature. Thank you, sir. On to the next question. This question is a pretty long one. So please listen to it carefully. And as I read this question, Identity Card by S. Joseph, who was a Malayalam poet, is a landmark publication in igniting the flame of Dalit consciousness, and the red mark on the Dalit identity card was taken as a mark of humiliation, and they came together through literature to fight this injury and through the consolidation of literary responses. Do you think it conceptualized the question of Dalit existence?
Oh, it's a very long question.
Yeah, it is
a long question. I try to answer this. Yes. S. Joseph is a professor of Malayalam literature. He is a a professor at Maharaja College. He is from Kottayam. His most of his poems are translated by a great poet K. Sachidanandan. Identity card and my sister's Bible are his famous poems.
Yes.
Identity card is written in a very different style. I read out a poem by Uriya poet, and this poem is very different. There is a very subtle undertone in this poem about the caste prejudice, about the upper caste, lower caste, binary, and I think for the sake of audience and my guests, I should read out the poem. It's not
please,
a
sir,
big
go
poem,
ahead.
A long poem.
Even the long one, please read out the poem.
In my student days, a girl came laughing. Our hands met kneading her rice and fish curry. On a bench, we became a Hindu-Christian family. I whiled away my time reading Neruda's poetry, and meanwhile, I misplaced my identity card. I noticed, she said, returning my card, the account of your stipend is entered there in red. Here begins the difference between a student, the one who is from upper caste and does not get any stipend, and there is one who is from the lower caste who gets a stipend. These days, I never look at a boy. The narrator of the poem says that these days there is a change in the voice. I never look at a boy and a girl lost in themselves. So the poem began with a romantic atmosphere and a very sweet kind of feeling that the hands of the boy and the girl, while eating together in the same plate, they met intimately when they were eating rice and fish curry. And the girl is from Hindu family and the boy is from Christian family. And now, these days, I never look at a boy and a girl lost in themselves. They will depart after a while. I won't be surprised even if they unite. Their identity cards won't have a scribbling in red. So the identity cards fix the identity of these two communities. And as we have in A Passage to India, that Dr. Aziz and Fielding at the end of the novel, they cannot be friends because the atmosphere is not conducive. Like
Thanks
this,
for the barrier.
Here the barrier is there and they cannot be together. And this is a recalling of the past incident when he was a student. And now he sees that that kind of intimacy is not there and it is not going to last long. So here, at a very young age, the boy feels the difference. And this kind of nuances of hypocrisy is expressed through a symbol of I card, identity. As I said, that Dalit literature is a quest for identity. A similar kind of thing is there in my sister's Bible, in which the sister's Bible is not a religious book, but it is a storage of the papers in the Bible. So what are the things in the Bible the sister keeps? Notices of feasts and a card from the cutthroat moneylender, loan application, ration book that has become loose, and photograph of the brother's child, and a paper that says how to knit a baby's cap, 100 rupees note. They are all kept in the Bible. But the important thing that makes it a religious book the important things that make it a religious book are not there. What are the things which are not there? The preface, the Old Testament and the New, maps, the red cover. So here, it is another very subtle satirical comment on the marginalized people who are further marginalized. And this is Sister's Bible. As Kamala Bhasin, I quote her again and again because I was very much influenced and impressed by her activism. She says that Dalit women are more Dalit. And in Dalit literature, it has been said that Dalit women are doubly cursed. One by patriarchy in their own community and another by the caste system. So here, S. Joseph is a very powerful voice who gives voice to the voiceless and to many other nuances of the hypocritical behavior that is rampant in this binary of upper caste and lower caste society. The hypocrisy, the hollowness of relationship, interpersonal relationship that is not possible, religious behavior that is not possible, and that is a very powerful message that goes in the present state of pseudo secular modernity. So that is my answer. Next question, please.
Okay, sir. It is very important to know that S. Joseph was one of the very important influences on the resurgence or on the emergence of Dalit literature. Sir, here, connected to this very question, I have another question which disturbs me when I flip through the pages of Dalit literature and Dalit discourse and whatever it is that why do you think that this casteist structure has been so hostile in the sense that it has completely marginalized or it has been very, 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 very inimical in its response while acknowledging the rise of Dalit sensibility. So was it, do you think this is caste at the root of it, or there is something more to it than what meets the eye?
Could you please repeat the question once more? Just give me 1 minute because someone is trying to enter.
I think it is Saloni trying to enter.
Yeah, I Saloni. Must send her. Just a minute.
Okay, sir. Please.
Yes. So, could you please repeat the question?
Yeah, yes. Yes. So I'm coming back to my question, which is connected to your response. It emanates from your response only. That do you think this casteist configuration or the casteist structure was very inimical early on in acknowledging the rise of Dalit sensibility and in acknowledging Dalit as a consciousness of its own?
Yes, it was inimical and it is still inimical because they are not allowed in the mainstream.
I will come to that. Yes,
they are not allowed. And
now, please, sir. Go
at
ahead.
Every stage, they are facing the problem. This happened with Om Prakash Balmiki, when he tried to publish his novel. It was not given any. He didn't get any response from the other stalwarts of Hindi literature. Only Rajendra Jadhav. He for 20 years his story was kept, and Rajendra Jadhav, he was very happy and he published it. And In fact, he gave the title Jutan, a very appropriate title. So caste is a barrier, and if I understand your question, that is inimical to the growth of Dalit literature. But this there is another
elitist bias.
Is another thing today, that this casteist bias in everything that is so rampant in today's India, it very dangerous thing, because everyone is seeking for the caste of everyone. If someone gets medal in the Olympic, they are trying to search for the caste of that person. And for example, if there is a leader, his caste men are organizing birth and death anniversaries, and they limit the personality of a great person who was a great person, but his personality is and his influence is limited by the people of the caste, as if he belongs to only that caste. So this kind of caste configuration that is in India even today, panchayat elections are going on, and you can see how the things are going on. So this is very deplorable thing seen in India.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, because that was in fact a question which stemmed from your response to the last response from your answer. So that's very well answered once again. Thank you very much, sir. And on to the next question, which is a very short question, but then it will have some wide ramifications in terms of response it is going to elicit from you. And the question reads very simply that why Om Prakash Balmiki is called the poster boy of Dalit literature?
Om Prakash Balmiki is very famous for his autobiographical novel Jutan. It was translated by a very famous person, Arun Prabha Mukherjee from Columbia University.
Yes,
and she has written a very beautiful introduction to it, a very erudite introduction about Dalit literature, Dalit aesthetics. It was translated in 2000, it was published in, originally published in Hindi, A Dalit Ki Atmakatha, in 1993. And it was translated in 2003. It is about Chuhra, because he is a Chuhra untouchable.
Yeah, right.
And he has problem with the Tagas, the Tyagis. And it is an autobiographical novel, the real life, based on the real life experience of Om Prakash Balmiki. But it is not about an individual. All these autobiographies, their protagonist is an individual, but this is, all these are about the community. And Om Prakash Balmiki's Jutan is a collection of memoir. It is a non-linear narrative. It is about his childhood memories and his childhood environment. Now, the important thing is that it is about the subhuman existence of Chuhra communities vis-a-vis the Tyagis. And Tyagis are not only Hindu Tyagis, they are also Muslim Tyagis. And the upper caste Muslims also, they behave like the upper caste Hindus. And there is a detailed description of that amidst hunger, starvation, deprivation, how the leftover food even reluctantly is relished because there was no alternative. Either they have to eat those leftover food or they have to die.
Yes.
They are looked down upon by the Tyagis, their hypocritical behavior. There is a very good description of Valmiki's going to a school and how he was given broom to sweep the entire school, and his mouth is full of dust, his face is full of dust, and he is always abused by the teacher. And he describes that how the upper caste people at night in darkness come to his ghetto to eat pork, but next day in the morning they are different. So this kind of hypocrisy he has described. So his tormented life made him introverted and irritable. His humiliation did not stop him to go ahead in life. He got a job. And then he recounts an incident that in a train, when he was traveling, there was an officer from the central government with family, and he was with his family, and they were having conversation, very jolly conversation, and suddenly the wife of the officer asked, what caste are you? And he said, I am a Bhangi, and they stopped talking. The entire journey, they didn't speak a single word to him because he was a Bhangi. So this kind of question is there.
Hasn't changed today, sir. Sorry. Hasn't changed
yes,
today?
There is a change. There is a change. There is a change.
Is it so perceptible that you can notice it very conspicuously?
No. It's there is a change. There is a lot of change. And I think in the remote villages, in the remote villages, maybe you will find the same kind of segregation. But in
not
the
only
cities,
segregation, I think. Do you think you are still very supple and flexible towards recognizing the fact that there is some kind of a social transformation involved with regard to Dalit existence?
I think there is a space carved out and for the Dalit existence, and the things have become more comfortable. Education has given them a lot of space and comfort, and they changed the lifestyle. So there is a change, but Jutan is important because it gave a voice to the voiceless.
Okay,
it is important for many reasons. It brought out something new and fresh and real to the reader. It connected the individual with the community. And the fellow sufferers, they identified themselves with Dr. Valmiki, Mr. Valmiki. And there was a sense of dignity and self-respect they felt when they found that his pain was alleviated because his trauma was lessened because he got education, he wrote a book. And he got acclaim as a writer. So all these things are very important. And he broke a tradition. And he broke the canon, the canonical literature. And he carved a niche for himself by writing this groundbreaking book, Canon. Jutan. In Hindi and English. Education freed him from the dark caves of wretchedness he suffered.
So, no longer they are the wretched of the earth.
I think situation has changed.
Has it changed politically or socially?
Socially, not in the remote villages, but in the cities, there is a change.
You do not suffer from any inhibition while offering your hand to have a shake hand with somebody who is completely ostracized?
No, in the cities, no. In the cities, there is no change. In the villages,
okay.
Yes.
So you have a very emphatic no to it, that things have changed and they are coming to the mainstream of the society. There is no inhibition involved anywhere, and their acceptance is much more higher than what it was, say, 20 years back. So politically, they are accommodated and socially they are accepted. Dr. Shalini Mishra, may I welcome you, sir?
Yes.
Thank you very much for joining us. And even though it is delayed by a few minutes, but then we take that delay because we all waited for you very patiently. And we are really grateful to you for finally appearing on Spain with us. So you are welcome.
Thank you, dear. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, sir. So I think you have responded to my question. Can I move on to the next one?
Yes, please.
See, some social movements like Adi Dharam movement in Bengal, Narayan Swami movement in Kerala, and Adi Dalit movement in Tamil Nadu quit the pitch for Dalit emergence as a dignified social entity, which led to the rise of Dalit discarding the sexist orientations within the Hindu caste hierarchy. So the question says that some religious movements had their own share of role in trying to reorganize this Dalit existence into the mainstream of the Hindu society. If I can be more exclusive in the use of my term, because it was the elite Hindu class that was hostile to the rise of this new literary sensibility through this Dalit writing. So the question, therefore, which I am trying to make it very clear to you, that do you think the roles of these religious movements, because there were some converts also, they were on a mission to convert the people from Dalit into Christianity, and this conversion also brought some kind of a fear within this Hindu society that they will lose a good chunk of Hindu populace by means of this conversion if they do not mend their ways. That is to say that if they do not open out to Dalit the way they were very conservative about opening out, and they were completely bumfuzzled because of their inhibitions and all that. So do you think that these religious movements had a role or had their own roles in emancipating the lot of the Dalit, sir?
Yes, there were movements. There were social movements, and in Bengal and Kerala, they were reform movements, and they were with the our freedom struggle. They were continuing along with side by side there. So in Bengal, we had
Adi Dharam movement
that was started by Raja Ram Mohan Roy and others. What has happened that they were the people who were outcast, because they used to flout the traditional things of Hinduism. So they had this kind of the Brahmins, particularly they were in the 18th and 19th centuries, the Brahmins of Bengal who were excommunicated, and they started this. Now, in Kerala, by Narayan Swami, there was a movement, and Narayan Swami is fondly known as Nanu Hassan, and it was in 1920s. So these were the reform movements with twin aims: the spiritual enlightenment, to make people, to teach them on the path of a spiritual attainment, and the second aim was very important, to teach them social equality. So that was the thing, that was a radical movement, and that has great impact on the Dalit movement of 20th century regarding the ideas of equality and social justice. There is another point in this, that when they said Adi, means they are the original people, they are the son of the soil, and the Aryans came from outside and they defeated them and enslaved them. So that was also there, like the untouchables in Karnataka, they are called Koliyas, and in Kerala they call Palayas, and in Tamil Nadu they are Adi Dravidas, and in Andhra Pradesh they are Adi Andhrites, and in Maharashtra they are Mahars. The Mahars, the people, the Mahar community, they had one problem. For example, in other estates, they were the untouchables, they had been given the duty to do, certain duty to do. But Mahars were without any duty and their life was very difficult. So I will come later regarding this with the reference to Swami Achyutanand, who in 1922 started a movement against Manu Smriti, and that was very important, and it has far-reaching consequences in the formation of Dalit literature, modern Dalit literature. So next question, please.
Okay, thank you very much, sir, because that was the question that came to me as an afterthought, and it emanated from your response only. So on to the next question, which is, I'm coming to Hindi literature, okay? So this segment will be based on the reaction of the mainstream Hindi literature, how it reacted to the rise of the Dalit sensibility, and how accommodative, or the way it was in, or how indifferent it was in its response to acknowledging the growth of a tendency within the framework of Dalit imagination, and how hostile they might have been early on towards them. So I will come to that. But then before that, I have a question. That three novels of Jagdish Chandra, Dhan Na Dharti Apni, Dhan Na Dhan Dharti Apni, Narak Kund Mein Vaas,
Dharti Dhan Na Apna,
Narak Kund Mein Vaas, and Zameen Apni To Thi, intensified Dalit sensibility to the extent that it helped them fight social injustices effectively, and in them found a bumper shoot to further Dalit cause. So my question to you is this: that do you think that these three important novels of Jagdish Chandra Dhan had a very decisive role in acknowledging, in recognizing, or in pushing forward the agenda of the Dalit imagination?
It was similar kind of initiative as I have already talked about the Marathi literature, and
yes, we have talked about them. Prakash
Balmiki's this Dharti Dhan Na Apna, in published in 1972, in which Kali and Gyanu are two characters, and it is about the Chamars of Punjab. And I feel that this kind of theme is a pan-Indian theme, and we find it everywhere, because Dalits, they have 16% of population in India.
Yeah.
And one thing would like to quote from Dharti Dhan Na Apna, quote, Mera yeh upanyas, meri kishoravastha, ki kuch avishmaraniya smritiyon aur uske daman mein chipi ek adamya vedana ki upaj hai. As I said to you earlier, that for your answering your first question, that Dalit literature is conceived in the wombs of pain, agony, misery, humiliation, and he says the same, adamya vedana ki upaj hai, and all these autobiographical stuff that is based on intense experience is very important. And that's why we say that Dalit literature is not important as a work of art, but as a work of experience that has shown a kind of facet of the people who have been marginalized for generations. So here also the same thing, and it has the same influence others had in the north of India, in Punjab region, because he talked about the Chamar and the story with the imagination. He has a love story between Kali and Gyanu. And that is the answer to your question. So next question, please.
Okay, so thank you very much, because this was an important aspect of the whole questioning session. And I think since it is written in Hindi, it did play a very important role in propelling the cause of Dalit writings in particular. So these three novels have had their own share of importance. Yes, sir.
Yeah, one thing I would like to add, that most of the novels written either in Marathi or Tamil and Telugu. They have been translated by international critics and writers. Okay. There are very important critics and writers who came to the villages, went to the slums, ghettos, talked to them. Even the people who were illiterate, but there was one lady who had a small shop, and she used to write something. So one foreigner came and collected all and published it in the form of a book. The important people who are in the field are John C.B. Webster, Josiah Racine, John Locke Racine. Dr. Gail Ohm Welt is very important because he's the chair of Dalit literature in U.S. And Eleanor Zilliot and Christopher Claffaret, they are very important people, and they have helped a lot in translating people's work, and that's how the readership has increased, and Dalit literature has acquired a very important place in the mainstream literature. Next question, please.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. That's what I wanted to know exactly, that whether these Hindi novels did help cause of Dalit writings in general. Moving on to the next question, which pertains to this Dalit Panther was formed in 1972, which was again a clarion call to assert Dalit identity, as the likes of Arjun Dangle, Bandhu Madhav, Babulal Gore, Madhav Desai, Namdev Dasal took the center stage, and works like Poison Bread was the kind of transition from activism to literary seriousness there. Do you believe that Arjun Dangle had a pivotal role in obfuscating the hostility of the elite Harry on Dalits, sir?
Yeah, that is a very important question. Dalit Panther of India in the 70s was influenced by the Black Panther of US.
Yes.
So simultaneously, we had Dalit Panther of India in Maharashtra, and Dalit Mahasabha in Andhra Pradesh, and Dalit Sangharsh Samiti in Karnataka, and Aru Dattiyar in Tamil Nadu. They were formed in response to the mainstream atrocities and suppression. They played a significant role in creating an ideological bond among the writer who were publishing sporadically. All of them gathered to a platform. And then they received overwhelming response, and they were translated into several languages. Regarding Arjun Dangle's Poison Bread, that was a groundbreaking novel, and it was also translated into many languages. It created a movement and gave a jolt to the custodians of mainstream Marathi literature. In that respect, it was a very important work. And after the publication of Poison Bread of Arjun Dangle, new parameters were established to judge a work of literature. And it is a matter of history that after some time, Dalit Panther lost its importance and got splintered into different organizations. But what was important of it? The importance of it was that in Maharashtra, in Marathi literature, Dalit literature made a vibrant appeal to the masses, and it carved a niche in Marathi literature, and it forced them to remove the traditional parameters of judging a work of art. It created a platform of the publication of new work, and that is very important. Now we have to see that these kinds of work, which were autobiographical in nature, based on personal experience, how far they go ahead to reach or to narrate a kind of socio-political reality. This the world has to see, that does Dalit literature go ahead, leaving behind the autobiographical writing, or the ire, the anger that has become so stereotypical?
Yes, that is.
Next question, please.
Sir, it's more than an hour. I think we have gone beyond an hour. It's almost 1 and 10 minutes, 1 hour and 10 minutes already. So we have to wrap it up also, and I don't have many questions left, though there will be always questions. Questions never come to end. So we are trying to, we will of course try to prune it to the extent that it becomes quite manageable while covering most of the aspects, as we have already covered a huge chunk of grounds through your responses to the questions. The question, therefore, which is a very important one for me also, and possibly for the viewers also, and those who are interested in the literature or discourse, that the question is a bit disturbing also, in the sense that it raises an eyebrow and has a skeptical temper about questioning something which is not generally questioned. And that is, why mainstream Hindi literature was hostile to the rise of Dalit sensibility?
I was just looking at the questions put forward. There is one Dr. Chandrakant Langare.
Okay, we will come to the questions after we wrap it up. Yes. We will come, that will be the last segment.
Now,
so the question, you got the question,
last
sir?
Last question of yours regarding Hindi.
Not the last literature. Question necessarily, because there will be some question connected to your response to this question.
Okay. So, regarding Hindi literature, I have to go back. As I told you, that Swami Achyutanand Harihar, he criticized Manu Smriti. He had great impact on Dalit literature. He wrote in one of his poems, I quote only two lines, quote, day in and day out, this Manu Smriti is burning us, not letting us climb up, it is degrading us. Mm. I would like to add here something, because a very knowledgeable person is there watching us, is Dr. Ram Narayan Tiwari from Gajipur. He is a professor of English, but he is a great scholar of Lok.
I welcome him.
I had a one-hour talk regarding this, and he has mentioned here that even Brahmins are not allowed in Dalit rituals.
Okay.
And okay. He told that me is, that there were many types of segregations there in the villages. Even the Dalit is not allowed in the subcaste to drink water from the house of another subcaste. So he said one thing that is very important, that we are reading books, the great books written by people who do not have knowledge of the villages. And most of the rituals which have died out, we don't have any idea. And there is no historiography. So, these kinds of things occur. He told me that there are many lacuna in Dalit literature. And we will do Dalit literature 2 regarding this. And we will invite him, and he will talk about it. So, this is, since I am reading out a critique of Manu Smriti by Swami Achyutanand Harihar, this idea came to my mind, that sometimes between late 19th century and early 20th century, one of the earliest statements was about him. Now, we all know that Mahabir Prasad Dwivedi, when it comes to Hindi literature, in his Saraswati, he published a poem, Ek Achhut Ki Aah by Hira Dom. It was published in 1914. And that was the time of Gandhi's political philosophy and the uplift of the untouchable, what we call in Hindi, Achyuto Dhar. And then came the time of progressive phenomena in literature, Progressive Writers Association, of which Premchand was a part, and he talked about, he wrote Godan and Kafan. Yesterday, Dr. Tiwari said that he wrote Godan, and that is not based on social reality, because those kinds of people, they do not do Godan. Yes. And it is a kind of false okay. thing that is being read by people and criticized, and pages and pages have been written on this story. So, what I find that in Godan, Hori has a vision. And his vision is to donate a cow to the Brahmin. So, that is the meaningful existence of his life. So, this does not take us anywhere. There is no social uplift because of this act of Godan. On the other hand, there is another writer, his name is Jayaprakash Kardam, whose Chappar is going against Godan. And it is a more realistic portrayal of village life and the Dalit people, the untouchable. So, people question Premchand's portrayal of Dalit.
Madhav Angesuya in particular, yes.
That how far it is there. Now I come to Kafan, the dehumanization of people because of poverty. And I think, Dr. Ashrafi, you have already expressed your uneasiness about this story. And yes, Dr. Jyotsna, right. Who is not able to connect, okay. She also had the same feeling about it, about Kafan. In 1935, because this is related to a question put by Dr. Jaya Prasad, that why Dalit writers think that their experience is more important than the non-Dalit. So here there are some non-Dalit writers like Premchand, like Mulk Raj Anand, who has Untouchable written in 1935. The character Bhakha is a cleaner of latrine, and he is not able to find his way out. His predicament has no end. But what he hears about some technical invention that will ease his life. If there is he heard about WC, and that will make his life easier. So here, Mulk Raj Anand is thinking of future, thinking of technical innovation, and thinking of scientific change brought about by that. Again, the problem of Premchand in Rangbhumi, because he wrote Sur Das Chamar. And this Sur Das Chamar, when he referred his caste, it was derogatory and it was very offensive. And in 2004, the copies of Rangbhumi were burnt by some activists. And what happened, that the word Chamar was replaced by Dalit in the student's children edition of the story later on. So here, what is important is the Dalit consciousness, Dalit Chetana, that Dalit writing created a kind of Dalit Chetana. And this Dalit Chetana was created by the Dalit writers, what they call it, Dalit consciousness. In the mainstream Hindi writer, Hindi writing, there were two important names who helped the Dalit writers, and they supported. Even Namor Singh was not very happy. and it didn't come. I read an article only published yesterday by Priyadarshan on Namor Singh, in which it is very interesting that Mr. Priyadarshan writes, I quote him, that it was published in a scrawl on Saturday, October 9, 2021. Quote, Dalit and feminist voices in Hindi literature did not receive a proper welcome in his house of criticism. Referring to Namor Singh, Priyadarshan writes, quote unquote, that Dalit and feminist voices in Hindi literature did not receive a proper welcome in his house of criticism. As against this, Rajendra Yadav and Ramanika Gupta, they were very supportive of the Dalit writers. Both of them edited very important magazines. Ramanika Gupta edited Yuddharat Aam Aadmi since 1989-87, and Rajendra Yadav, it is all history, that he edited Hans since 1984, and he used to inspire people, and Ramanika Gupta had Dalit Sahitya Varshiki, helped them publish by Jarpakas Kardam, and very important to create social awareness informed by B.R. Ambedkar and against caste society and social equality, and he was the undisputed historical leader regarding this. And this is all I have regarding the place of Dalit literature in mainstream Hindi literature. So,
okay, sir. Thank you very much. That is somewhat a very debatable question. And that was a very debatable question. And the answer will remain as debatable as it has been. So, I want to go back to Premchand, if the time permits us. Can I have a question on him? Particularly in the context of this Dalit discourse or Dalit writing, that Premchand, why these Dalit writers like Arjun Dangle, Babulal Gore, Bandhu Madhav Dasar, why these writers are not happy with Premchand, particularly with regard to the projection of characters in stories, because they have an accusation against Premchand that Premchand did not do justice to subalterns generally, and he never glorified them in the stories. For example, Kapan is also one of the examples of it. Like both Madhav and Ghesu, they are completely dehumanized, and they come from the same subaltern background. So Premchand had a kind of, do you think it was prejudicial on part of Premchand, and or did he think, did he have a kind of a bias against this subaltern consciousness which made him do this? Was that a surrealist story, or can Kafan be taken as a realistic tale which completely left two individuals numbed, paralyzed, powerless, and they were complete duffers like? So how do you respond to this? That do you find any kind of a bias on the part of Premchand against this Dalit existence or Dalit questions of dignity, of acceptability, of acknowledgement, of social mobility and all that, sir?
I am not a very competent authority to talk about Premchand, because I have to reread him again and see the whole thing in the new light. Jyotsna ji has not joined.
Rejoined, yes.
I wanted to request her to talk about Premchand, because she would be the right person to talk about it. But one thing I forgot to tell you, that these Dalit writers of Dalit literature, they also question the inclusion of Nirgun Bhakti Sakha into mainstream Hindi literature, like the poems of Kabir, Rai Das and Chokha Mela. They were not happy that they were included in Hinduism in the Gyanashri Sakha of poetry writing. And they said that this kind of inclusion creates a rift between Brahmanic and Dalit identity formation. So they have sometimes a point to make. And when they are not happy with Premchand, there must be something, because Premchand is known for his social realism and what we call Yatharthavad and Adarshonmukh Yatharthavad.
The way it comes to us.
Yes.
The way it comes to us, the way it is presented to us that he was a writer of social realism. The how much of realism is there is always a question, which has some kind of a skepticism about it. So, okay. Please complete your answer, sir. Please.
I think Premchand should be read in the framework of new historicism to new understand the entire thing.
Oh. Okay, let's leave it to new historicism as far as Premchand is concerned, because it is seeking a reinterpretation of Premchand today in the context of this Dalit writings particularly. So I think, sir, the last question that I come to is that, do you think that something written by the elite imagination on the oppression of the subaltern will have the same fire and venom as it will be by a subaltern himself or herself? Sir?
Regarding Dalit literature, this is, they claim that a non-Dalit cannot write as faithfully as they write about their experiences. Yeah, in response to this, Kashinath Singh, Kashinath Singh has a very interesting thing to say. He says that ghoda ke bare mein likhne ke liye ghoda hona zaruri nahi.
Okay.
Now, I think that a non-Dalit can write about Dalit consciousness.
Okay.
But
you
the
think
kind
you can,
of, but again, Om Prakash Valmiki has a very important thing to say about this. He says that the elite class must step into the shoes of the Dalit and go and live in the filth of the areas of the Bangis, and he cannot survive.
There you are. That's what my question was. That was my question was. Yes.
If he cannot survive, if he cannot live in the stench and the stinking
ghettos
surrounding of that, so how can he write about it? And how can he write? Because Om Prakash Valmiki, when he was taken to his school by his father, he likes his father a lot, because his father protested against the headmaster. So whenever he comes to the school in the morning, the headmaster gives him a broom and tells him to sweep the entire school. And he is not allowed to drink water. So all these things are very important.
Even Jagjivan Ram was not allowed to drink water from the same.
This kind of humiliation, this kind of physical and mental torture, if one does not undergo, then how can he write about the experience?
One very honest response I want from you. As we wrap it up now, almost on the cusp of closing it, when we pass through these ghettos and pariah quarters, don't we close our nostrils while crossing those areas? And don't you think that we aren't very open to be very nice and gentle towards them, to accommodate them much the same way as we accommodate other people in our society? We still have a bundle of inhibitions against them. We are driven by our own biases and prejudices. And the elite imagination is not predisposed to the understanding that you can have a glass of water from their hand without any unease. So I want an honest response to this question, because this is the last one that I would
yes,
I am
we
asking.
Feel uncomfortable, and it should not be like that.
Should not be like that, but is it not like that or what? There's a difference. Again, there is an element of idealism in your response, that it should not be like that. That means there is something which is like it.
Om Prakash Balmiki criticizes the Constitution of India.
Yeah.
For this reason, he criticizes the Constitution of India. Because in Constitution of India, all people are equal. But in reality, all people are not equal.
Not equal. That's yeah. Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir.
That was my...
Yes. Okay. Thank you very much for your responses. Generally, your responses have been very convincing. They are very comprehensive. They have been
Can
very compendious.
Can we have some observations from the guests?
Well, we will. I will seek those observations from anybody who's interested in coming up with their observations. But one last that I will add to this, about the discussion that we had on this Dalit lighting and the discourse. So that the two works which are perhaps were very historical in the context that they finally built up. Those two works were, one was Flaming Feet by D. Nagaraj, and the other was No Alphabet in Sight by Satyu and M.S. Satyu and Satyanarayan,
MS
K. Satyanarayan. Yeah. So these two works also had a very important role in trying to define fundamentally what this Dalit sensibility was as a matter of principle, as a matter of literary response, and as a matter of ideological impulse. It did imply, it did entail some basic issues within the ambit of its concern, while reaching out to the larger literary world. And today, I think the hostility has really come down to a very great extent, and we aren't all that hostile in our responses to Dalit literature. It has gone on to become a part of the Indian syllabi, academic syllabi, because it has gone on from Dalit literature, it has become Dalit Vimarsh. So now it is a Vimarsh. You are engaged in this Vimarsh, I am engaged in this Vimarsh, and the whole lot is engaged in this Vimarsh, which is quite kind of a discourse. So thank you very much, sir, for your some very, very great responses and your very scholarly responses to some of my very bromide, some of my very commonplace questions, because that was based on my own understanding of what the literature seeks to represent in terms of ideological stance. So thank you very much, Dr. Anil K. Prasad, for having given such a brilliant kind of response to some very ordinary, some very commonplace, some very bromide, and some very unconvincing questions, and at times disturbing too. But then you have kept your cool, you have kept your composure, you haven't overreacted to those questions, and that is a very and you had a fine balance between those turbulences, disturbances, and a very sensible literary response to some very provocative questions.
Thank you very much. And again, okay. The fine balance of Rohinton Mystery is about Dalits.
Yes.
And two writers, Arundhati Roy and Rohinton Mystery, they wrote about Dalits, and fine balance is about them. It is about a pickpocket.
We can take observations of those who are interested in coming up with their observations. Please, anybody, Dr. Madhavi, Dr. Salin Mishra, Dr. Who else is there? Today, Professor Saloni Kumar did me a message today.
I sent her the link.
She had a complaint that she was not given entry. She was not allowed entry.
I sent her the link, but she is not responding.
No, she did try to interrupt. Perhaps there was some technical snag or something like that.
Yeah. Yes. And Mr. Nayak also didn't enter because he
had some engagement. So anyway,
I know it's very easy to enter, but he could not.
Something, there's no big deal. But anyway, so Viru, who's absent because he's a very young scholar and should have been there on board. Nevertheless, Dr. Shailendra Mishra, if you can add something to what we already discussed, or if you can have your own impressions on how Dalit literature is going today, if we can get your observations, we would be particularly happy about it. Dr. Shailendra Mishra. Can you hear me, sir? Dr. Shailendra Mishra? Can you hear me, sir? Dr. Shailendra? Hello?
Please unmute yourself.
Unmute yourself, Dr. Shailendra Mishra, please. Hello? Can you hear me, sir, Dr. Shailendra Mishra? Hello? Anyway, meanwhile, we can move on to Dr. Madhavi. Dr. Madhavi, do you have any observation to make?
Yeah.
Madam,
first of all, I thank Literary Responses and I thank Professor Anil Kumar Prasad for his very informative presentation. And thank definitely you. It is the result of an extensive and exhaustive research on the subject. In fact, I am not very much into Dalit literature, but from what I have learned, from what I have heard and learned today, somehow the same question that you had posed, in fact, will all this resonate with the present generation in the cities, sir? Dalits, children. In fact, that Dalit itself is slightly a disturbing word somehow.
Yeah,
now, today,
yes.
Because you said Dalit
today, yes.
Today. As an adjective, Dalita in Sanskrit means fragmented. Will it really resonate with the...
Yeah.
Will it really resonate with the children of Dalits? Again, within quotations. Will this past Dalit literature have a future?
Yeah, Dr. Anil K. Prasad, I think please go ahead with your response to this question.
Yes. Sorry, I was trying to...
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Yes, please. Could you please repeat the question?
Yeah. No, in fact, no. First of all, I thank you, sir, for all the exhaustive information that you have presented so well. Just as a, just before this, in fact, a question was posed where the same situation doesn't exist in the cities. So my doubt is, will it really resonate with the present generation in the cities, the children of the Dalits of the past? And I was saying that the word Dalit itself as an adjective is slightly not very convincing today, maybe. Dalit literature as an adjective. Will it have a future? It has a glorious past, but will it have a future?
This is a very interesting question about the nomenclature of Dalit. Because this has a long history. Dalit as a noun and Dalit as an adjective was used by, first of all, used by Mahatma Jyotirao Phule and B.R. Ambedkar. And it was taken as a good word as against Harijan, because they thought that Harijan is patronizing. So they wanted the word Dalit, because Dalit expresses their experience and their sense of identity without insulting. Although there were many words used by other people. For example, the Britishers used depressed classes, scheduled caste. So this is a very important thing, that Dalit is not a word that is pejorative or derogatory. But they are happy with the word Dalit because it comes from Sanskrit dal dhatu.
Dalita.
It means crust, crack open, split, grind.
Yeah,
so from this we have Dalit. So this is very important that they accepted the word Dalit as opposed to the word Harijan, because they were not happy with the word Harijan. And there were many other words. For example, Kansi Ram uses the word Bahujan. Kanchi Alaya uses the word Bahujan. I didn't refer to Kanchi Alaya. He's a very important...
Yeah. Why I'm not a Hindu?
Yes. He is a very important voice in this. But anyway, we are
no,
not...
No, but will it resonate with the present generation, sir?
The present generation are not
born and
unhappy
brought up
with
in cities.
Dalit. They are not unhappy because Dalit expresses their political identity as opposed to the caste name. So they are not happy with the caste name, but they want their political identity. They want their realignment with the mainstream. That is very important. So Dalit is related to their experience, their joys and sorrows.
Yeah.
Because they were Dalit, they were suppressed.
Yes.
Even today they are as much suppressed.
Their forefathers were suppressed, but not the present generation. That is.
I don't think, here I do not agree with this statement that today they do not feel oppressed or ostracized as much as they felt in the past. I don't think there is much of a social transition involved with regard to a Dalit identity. So we are as much averse to them as our forefathers had been. And we don't see. That's what my question is. A simple question is that, will you accept a glass of water from?
Yes, I will.
And there are no personal choices. I'm talking on behalf of a community which is elite. Will it be elite?
We are talking about ideologies, not about persons.
Ideology is okay. You may say yes to it, but practically it will be very... See, there will be some eyebrows within your family if you do that. Very honestly.
Somehow, maybe, I don't know, maybe I'm the wrong person to answer because I've been brought up in a cosmopolitan atmosphere. Really, I don't know much about this. But somehow, let me come out with this. I belong to a Brahmin family, but my mother-in-law, my mother, my grandmother, they were all very kind people. They had their boundaries, but they were all very humane.
Humane aspect is something different from the aspect of the acceptability. That's something very different. That's something a very different issue. I am a Muslim. I have no such experience of what is untouchable because untouchability is not in Islam. It doesn't happen generally in our society that we have anybody condemned to untouchability. We do that. But then, of course, having seen around this, the Indian, the so-called Indian society, which is a very cosmopolitan society, blend of the two. We have the subalterns, we have the Harijans, we have Dalits, you have the elites and all that. There is almost a coexistence now. But the question which is very disturbing one, that somebody... But today even the question is, somebody who qualifies this UPSC exam and comes through reservation is referred to as a quota wala, generally. So he's not given that kind of honor, he's not given that kind of dignity which you generally give to somebody who is from a background other than this reservation umbrella.
But he has already got it. He has already got it through the quota. So what is wrong in saying he got it through the quota?
Nothing wrong. I think in terms of treatment, there is something wrong because they tend to isolate that quota wala people. That these people are from quota wala and therefore they cannot be brought within the
ambit of the government's policies themselves should be questioned, sir, because we have the scheduled castes. We have the backward caste. Somehow I think
OBC. Now there is another term, OBC. OBC literature.
EBC, economically backward class. That's
OBC. And then we have, there is one also parallel literature almost going today, and that is OBC literature. So as long as we have this segregation in terms of categorizing literature, that this is the literature of the oppressed, that this is the literature of the black, this is the literature of the apartheid, this is the literature of the Dalit. That's what the whole problem is.
Yes. That is the poet says, the woman poet from Tamil Nadu, she says that there is no HPR literature and there is no Brahmin literature. Why is there the literature? And
categorization is
exactly. True.
They say that this is the only Dalit teacher in the school and I feel bad.
Yes,
That's where you have this bias. At the back of your mind, when you refer to somebody that is the only Dalit literature left in the school, that means you are trying to dehumanize him and you are trying to demean him in the sense that
which is actually very bad.
That's why I would like to say something, that caste is not a physical monster. It is more of a psychological phenomenon.
Psychological and emotional. The emotional
and also politicized, sir.
And the politicization
and
of the caste
structure. Yes. Yeah.
And even in newspapers, when somebody dies, it's a normal human being. But if it's a Dalit, a Dalit person has been Dalit.
There are overreactions from, you tend to react in a very different way when a Dalit is lynched. Say a Dalit has been lynched. And then our reactions are somewhat very different from our general reaction to somebody who is lynched from the other community or so. So as long as we have this categorization, or as long as these categorizations persist with us, I think we will continue to be compartmentalized like that only.
Yes, sir. True. Thank you, sir.
So on this very note, should I close the discussion or do you have some other observations?
I think Dr. Jyotsna Prasad has to say something.
Okay, please go ahead, madam. Please.
And take 2-3 minutes, not more than that.
No problem, no problem, sir. We are here for 1 hour and 44 minutes we have already, so we can give her 5 to 6 minutes more to make it 2 hours or so. So she can go ahead with her observations.
सबको जितने भी लोग पैनल में है चाहे जो भी सुन रहे हैं सबको नमस्कार और ये बहुत अच्छा डिस्कशन रहा और मैं चूंकि टाइम का लिमिटेशन है और मेरा मैं अंदर जा नहीं पा रही थी पैनल में इसलिए समय मेरे पास कम है कहने तो बहुत कुछ था लेकिन अभी मैं माधवी जी से ही बात जहां से बात शुरू हुई वहीं से मैं आगे बढ़ाना चाहूंगी कि ये जो भी आप जो कह रही हैं वो राजनीतिक ज्यादा है दलित साहित्य में दलित साहित्य के को जितने ही ऊंचा नहीं ले गया गया है उसको राजनीतिक ही से क्योंकि वहां संख्या अधिक है वोट अधिक मिलने का ये है तो हर लोग अपनी रोटी सेकने के लिए वहां कहते हैं और आपने जो बोली आपने जो कहा ना कि मेरी माँ और मेरी नानी और मेरी दादी तो अपवाद से रूल नहीं बनता है आज भी गांव में जाइए तो बहुत कुछ हम लोग पढ़े लिखे हैं हम लोग समझदार हैं पढ़े लिखे परिवार को बिलोंग करते हैं लेकिन ऐसी बात नहीं है और इसलिए गांव में अभी भी छुआछूत है हम लोग सिवान में जब एमए कर रही थी डीएवी कॉलेज में तो डीएवी कॉलेज में जाने का एक शॉर्टकट रास्ता था तो उसको डोमटोली कहा जाता था
right,
और बाद में वो राजेंद्र नगर हो गया तो उसमें सच में ये बात कर रही हूँ कि हम लोग ये भी हो सकता है कि जन्म से उस तरह के वातावरण में उस रोड में गुजरे नहीं है तो जितनी लड़कियां हम लोग के ग्रुप की थी सब नाक पर वो कपड़ा रख लेती पट्टा अपना रख लेती थी क्योंकि वो सुअर और चारों तरफ से सुअर था हम लोग को तो बच बच के भी जाना रहता था कि नाली में वो लेटे हुए हैं हम लोग के कपड़ा में टच करके हम लोग को कॉलेज जाना है तो ये बात सही है और इसी बात को जितने भी ये लोग हैं दलित हैं और एक आपने कहा प्रेमचंद वाली बात उतना टाइम नहीं है मैं थोड़ी थोड़ी बात केवल कहना चाहूंगी कि प्रेमचंद जो थे वो अंबेडकर जी से इतने प्रभावित थे उससे ज्यादा वो गांधी जी से प्रभावित थे और ये लोग चाहते थे कि अंबेडकर वादी लोग कि उस जो पुराण पंथी है जो भी वर्ण व्यवस्था है उसको ध्वस्त कर दिया जाए इवन मैंने पढ़ा था एक मलयालम कोई है वो तो हिंदी भाषा से भी नफरत करता है कि हिंदी भाषा एक दिन खत्म हो जाएगा इंग्लिश में जी अभी नाम मैं भूल रही हूँ मलयाली कोई है दलित राइटर है तो इन प्रेमचंद जी शुरू किए थे लेकिन ये गांधी जी से भी प्रभावित थे और हरिजन को ये लोग पसंद नहीं करते हरिजन वर्ड को पसंद नहीं करते हैं क्योंकि साउथ के मंदिरों में जो देवदासियां होती हैं उनके जो पुत्र होते हैं बच्चे होते हैं पुत्र नहीं बच्चे जो होते हैं उनको भी हरिजन कहा जाता है लेकिन उनका सामाजिक स्टेटस कुछ नहीं है वह नाजायज है एक शब्द में कहिए वो नाजायज है तो इन लोग को वो हरिजन नहीं चाहिए था अभी मैंने एक जगह पढ़ा था ओम प्रकाश वाल्मीकि का एक लेख है उसमें उन्होंने कहा है कि ये जो हम लोग बहुत खुश हैं इससे दलित लिटरेचर दलित शब्द से एक शब्द मिला जिसे हम लोगों ने खोजा है और ये हम लोगों को जो हम लोग हाशिए करते सब सबकी रचनाएं पढ़ी है इसमें छटपटाहट केवल है उनको मेन स्ट्रीम में आने की छटपटाहट है वो जो कुछ भी कहते हैं उसका एक है एक मुख्य उद्देश्य है कि वो मेन सब आम जनता की तरह हर तरह की बराबरी वो चाहते हैं तो वो वहां लिखते हैं कि हम लोग खुश हैं कि हम लोग को एक दलित शब्द मिला है जिसमें हम जो दल का बोध कराता है हमारे पूरे ग्रुप को हम लोग जितने हैं वो ग्रुप के को बोध कराता है हम हाशिए पर नहीं है इसमें हम सभी इसमें जो है वो मेन स्ट्रीम में है दलित लोगों में इसलिए उनको दलित पसंद है लेकिन अब सरकार चाहती है कि जो पिछड़े हैं उनको कोटा के थ्रू चाहे सरकार भी क्या करती है कि ये जितनी भी अनुसूचित जातियां हैं तो उसमें जो सरकार आती है अपने अनुसार कुछ जातियों को डाल देती है, कुछ को दलित से महादलित में कर देती है, कुछ को महादलित से दलित में कर देती है। तो ये फिक्स तो है नहीं कि दलित में कितने रहेंगे, कौन कौन से कास्ट रहेंगे, लेकिन उसमें ये है कि ये फिक्स नहीं है। तो साहित्य में भी ये प्रॉब्लम हो गया है कि ये कैसे ये किया जाए, कि इसको कैसे संभाला जाए। और प्रेमचंद की जो बात होती है तो प्रेमचंद को ये लोग मानते ही नहीं है, क्योंकि प्रेमचंद को उनसे सहानुभूति हो सकती है। दो तीन है, जैसे ठाकुर का कुआं ये है और इस तरह की है। कुछ लोग तो कफन को भी मानते हैं, लेकिन कफन को मैं वैसा नहीं मानती हूँ। शूद्र है उनकी एक कहानी, तो शूद्र में भी एक केवल है कि झोपड़ी से उसको अलग, वो लोग अलग रह रहे हैं। तो जो घर गई हुआ है, तो प्रेमचंद को हम लोग और लोग मानते हैं कि दलित का उनमें है, और पहले रचनाकार हैं हिंदी साहित्य में, पहले हैं। वैसे इस दलित शब्द का तो प्रयोग निराला जी ने भी किया है कविता में एक दो जगह, लेकिन इनका विद्रोह जो है ना, वो रैदास वाला विद्रोह है, ब्राह्मण से नहीं। जैसे डॉक्टर प्रसाद ने कहा है कि ब्राह्मण से नहीं, ब्राह्मणवाद से परेशानी है इन लोग को। तो यहाँ भी रैदास भी कहते हैं कि ब्राह्मण को मत पूजिए जो हो गुण से हीन। तो जब कोई भी समाज में रूल बनता है और उसमें कुरीतियां आ जाती है, ये वर्ण व्यवस्था तो बना था कर्म पर आधारित, लेकिन ये जातिगत हो गया तब इसमें कुरीति आ गई। अब ब्राह्मण पढ़ा लिखा हो, अनपढ़ हो, कुछ भी हो, तो वो पूजा जाएगा। तो इनसे तो समाज के जो दलित वर्ग है उसको तो आक्रोश होगा ना। तो इसलिए वो कहते पूजिए चरण चंडाल के जो गुण ज्ञान प्रवीण। तो प्रेमचंद को ये लोग अपने में नहीं कहते हैं, क्योंकि इनको वो भोगा हुआ, इनका दुख वो भोगा हुआ नहीं है। उनके लिए वही दलित रचनाकार हैं जो उस दुख को भोगे हुए हैं। इनको सहानुभूति किसी की नहीं चाहिए, समानुभूति चाहिए, उस दर्द को महसूस करना चाहिए। और इसीलिए अभी जो कोटे वाली जो बात हुई है, तो इस पर अनिता भारती की एक रचना है, एक थी कोटे वाली, तो वो स्कूल की टीचर है, उसको कितना कितने तरह से परेशान किया जाता है। तो ये है। और इसके साथ साथ जितनी महिला दलित, ऐसे हिंदी में बहुत नगण्य हैं, लेकिन जितने भी हैं वो उनके साथ है कि वो कई तरह के दलित मानती हैं। तो उसमें महिला का भी है कि महिला को भी वो एक दलित का ही एक रूप मानती हैं। तो इसमें सिकंजे का दर्द है, वो सुशीला टाकबोरे का, तो उसमें माँ पिता सबका है। और वही है दोहरा अभिशाप है कौशल्या वैसंत्री का, तो इसमें है कि औरत होना एक अपने आप में एक दलित से कम नहीं है, और उसके बाद वो दलित की औरत है, तो डबल दुख हो जाता है उसको। तो ये जो है दुख है, वो नौकरी में भी जाती है तो घर में, बाहर हर जगह उनको परेशानी है। घर में भी वो दलित में जो सब लोग सह रहे हैं वो भी सह रहे हैं, जो पुरुष वर्ग द्वारा दिया जा रहा है, प्रताड़ित किया जा रहा है, वो भी सह रही हैं। और वहां भी जो दूसरे जनरल कोटे के हैं, उन लोगों द्वारा उन पर ये कोटे वाली एक है भी, अनिता भारती का है, एक थी कोटे वाली, तो उसको किस तरह से जलील किया जाता है सामान्य लोगों द्वारा। तो उसकी मानसिक स्थिति को बहुत ही अच्छे ढंग से वर्णन किया गया है। तो मेरे ख्याल से मेरा समय हो गया होगा, और कहने को बहुत है, फिर कभी हम लोग इस टॉपिक पर बात होगी तो बात होगी। और माधवी जी की भी थोड़ी सी बात जो थी मैंने बताई, आपने भी जो कहा, ज्यादा समय तो नहीं है, लेकिन फिर भी मैंने कोशिश की कि कुछ बात उसमें बता दूं। ठीक
जी, ओके, थैंक यू वेरी मच मैडम, थैंक यू वेरी मच मैडम डॉक्टर ज्योतना प्रसाद, थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर योर शेयरिंग योर ऑब्जर्वेशंस विद अस। Now we are down to the final question before we close it, or before we sign out from this program. There is a question, sir, by Dr. Jaya Prasad. You would like to answer that question? If you have seen that question, I hope you have seen that question, please. Sir, is Dalit literature an attempt of the marginalized to rebuff those who like to talk on their behalf and hog the limelight? Do they resent being patronized and wish to speak for themselves rather than allowing others to talk about them? Sir, this is the question. from Dr. Jaya Prasad. Sir.
Hello.
Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, now it's okay. I have unmuted.
Okay, so please listen to the question. You got the question?
Yes, question? The question is in front of me. Is Dalit literature an attempt of the marginalized to rebuff those who like to talk on their behalf and have the limelight? So, it is not the case. It is not the case. They try to, as I said, that it is a kind of consciousness that leads to the process of social change. It is a part of social movement of equality and justice. And it is also a movement for political identity. It cannot be seen only as a literary perspective, but also from a sociological perspective. So here, naturally, they have anger and they have a sense of alienation from the mainstream. So that anger is there, as the poet Sukirt Rani says, that the moment you come out of your house, caste chases you like a dog. But the problem is that they do not want others to write, because they think that their voice is not authentic. So they have a point. To my understanding, in my opinion, according to me, they have a point that since we have not gone through that kind of horrendous experience, we cannot express our experience
to that extent. Yes. The intensity
so that
problem,
is their
yes.
point.
The heat and intensity of the experience. Okay, sir, have you answered the question?
Yes, I think this is
okay.
what I have.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Jaya Prasad. Please, Dr. Madhuri.
Yeah, actually, my husband, I would like to introduce my husband, if you permit me to
introduce him. Sure.
Professor of Physics. So he just wants to say a few words. He was just listening to our conversations.
Please, go ahead, sir.
Is it okay, sir? Is it okay?
You are welcome.
Okay, welcome, welcome, please.
Dr. Ashrafi, and you know Professor Prasad and Dr. Jyotsna.
Namaskar.
Yes. Namaskar.
Jai Namaskar.
I was following the complete talk over the last 1 hour approximately, and I wanted to just express a few of my personal observations and some of the things that I have recorded in my mind regarding this term, Dalit. By birth, everyone is a Dalit. Through practices, one reaches a certain stage of enlightenment and remains in history as being classified in that segment of livelihood. But unfortunately, over a period of time during the past 2 to 3 centuries, some of the segments which were associated with unhygienic practices in the society have been alienated and separated from the normal functionality of the society, and they were put away from the regular stream of mixing with the society due to scientific causes initially. But that led to a political exploitation by the rulers, and they have categorized these segments into a slavery and a downtrodden segment in the society, And I think this is what has sprouted the term Dalit literature. And I think it is high time we give up that word, and this word should be removed from the dictionary.
Done away with, yes.
Because you are trying to still remind of the nonsensical, non-existential practices. I sit with a person of any community and I am comfortable. So is every citizen in India. But when it comes to encashing the vote bank, these people are bifurcating and exploiting the society to encash it. I hope and pray that in the coming decade or so, this Dalit literature will be a past thing in literature. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to speak.
Thank you, sir, because that's a very important suggestion and that's a very constructive suggestion to have this word completely eliminated or removed from the dictionary itself so that it doesn't remind anyone of his or her wretched past. So that's the very convincing argument made in favor of this this generalization of the term, and then let them come at par with the rest of the segments of the society without being associated with Dalit. That's very important observation made. And we take that observation of yours. Sir, thank you very much for that.
Thank you, Dr. Ashrafi. Thank you, Dr. Anil. Thank you. And thank you, Dr.
Welcome.
For permitting me to speak a few words, though I am not.
You are the part of this
segment.
Program.
You are a constituent of this program, sir.
Yes, so you are the part of this program. Wasn't that in... You are always welcome.
You are welcome, Dr. Madhvi. Thank you very much. Dr. Madhvi, thank you very much for bringing your husband into it.
Thank you so much.
He himself is an academician. It's always very important to know and to make him a part of the deliberation.
He's far away from us. He teaches physics.
that's absolutely no issue because physicists have gone on to win prizes in literature also. So yes, that's true. No issue. Subject is no bar. Yeah. So I think we come to the end of the program finally, sir. Do you agree?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Madhvi. Thank you. The professor of physics also, whose name we don't know still. What is his good name?
Shiva Prasad.
Professor Shiva Prasad. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Dr. Jyotsna Prasad. And thank you very much, Dr. Jaya Prasad, also for being a part of this deliberation. This was Dalit Literature Part 1. And we'll have Dalit Literature Part 2 also, so that we can quell some of the questions that we have still left in our minds. And some of the important dimensions of the problem that we couldn't go into, given though it is almost more than 2 hours and all that, but 2 hours can suffice to complete every single aspect of whatever comes within the ambit of Dalit concern. So we are very thankful to everybody, those who are offline, those who are online, and those who are the panelists and the part of this constituent of this deliberation. I, on behalf of the literary sponsors, once again, thank you very from the depth of my heart. And I am indebted to everybody for being a part of this deliberation. I don't know how constructive this deliberation was, but one thing is for sure, that you cannot have somebody like Dr. Anil K. Prasad in every part of the world who is ever prepared to answer your queries to your intellectual inquiry will be best addressed by him. And he's a wonderful, wonderful, a very humble individual with this range of information on just about every conceivable branch in the knowledge. So thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
You are welcome.
Okay.
So, goodbye.
So we are closing. Goodbye.
Yes.
Bye, everybody. Goodbye. For now. Bye for now. Not for bye for. Yes.
Bye for now.
Bye for now.
Yes.
Thank you. Oh, let's close.